wonderful, and we welcome you to this meeting of the Temple Baptist Church. Let's do something unusual. Would you stand with me, please? And Jonathan, come here at the pulpit and just lead all of us in Bless the Lord, O My Soul, Orchestra, all the folks, and we'll sing it to the glory of God. Here we go. Yes,
sir. Bless the Lord, O My Soul. Let all that is within me praise His holy name. We'll start from the very beginning. Sing this out as unto the Lord.
Wonderful. And you know, I saw Jonathan growing up here and playing the piano and singing and all of this, and it's just thrilling to see the Lord using these young men and women like He's using them, isn't He? Let me welcome all the friends who are joining us by means of radio as we broadcast the services live, and also welcome those who are joining us as we live stream the meetings on faithforthefamily.com and thetemplebaptistchurch.com. People from all across the country and all around the world watch us and pray for us and pray with us, and we're very thankful for that. I want us to pray together, may we? Would you join with me in prayer, please? And let's ask God's blessing on our meeting. Our Father, as we come into Thy holy presence, we thank Thee, Lord, that we have this privilege to come, not in our own merit, but on the merit of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and approach Thee, and come into the throne room and speak with Thee, Lord God. And we ask for Thy blessing on this meeting. Take it further than we could take it in our flesh and energy. Touch by Thy Spirit every part of this meeting, the singing, the preaching of Thy Word. May we glorify Thy name, Lord Jesus. Be all we should be for Thee. Speak to us and help us to yield all to Thee. We pray for those who do not know Thee as Savior, that this would be the glad hour in their lives when they come to know Thee, Lord Jesus, as their personal Savior. Speak to Thy children, we pray. May we be attentive and obedient children, ready to do Thy will at Thy bidding. And we shall give Thee glory for it. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray and ask these things, and for His glory. Amen. 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 All God's people said amen. Amen. Let's find our crown hymnal, please. You find it there and turn to hymn number 60. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And let's sing it to the Lord's glory. Hymn number 60.
Sing this wonderful hymn. Lift your voice, do your best.
Thank you. singing. Thank you. You may be seated. Our Temple Teen Choir is singing some selections that they sang from the Youth Congress. What a blessing that was to hear them singing. And we're thankful to have them singing in with us this evening. And Stephen and Lydia do a wonderful job leading them. They're going to be singing, "He is Mine and I Believe God."
Father, not my will, but thine.
What a blessing that was. What an encouragement you've been to us tonight, young people. And as they find their way back to their seats, I'd like to ask the ushers, if they would, to come forward with a bulletin. If you don't have a bulletin in your hand, if you'll mind to let the ushers know, they'll be very happy to give you one so we can pray together about the things that are happening this week at the Temple Baptist Church. If you'll notice on the front cover of the bulletin, we're praying much for the ministry in the United Kingdom. Crown UK this week begins their junior camp and then their teen camp. And we're praying that the Lord will do a mighty work there at Crown Hall. Many will be saved, others surrendering their lives to whatever God would have for them. And so let's pray especially about that ministry there. If you'll turn to the inside, we're praying for the coming revival. We know that God is able, and we're trusting that He'll begin that in our own hearts. And why not this evening, as we hear God's word, that He would send a revival in our own hearts tonight. We're praying for our special guest speaker, Dr. William McCrea. We're thankful that he's here. On the front of the bulletin, you saw the Houses of Parliament, and he is one of the members of the House of Lords. So we're very thankful to have him with us tonight preaching. What a blessing his message was to us this morning. What an encouragement. We're looking forward to a special camp this week. Brother Tom Odom will be preaching at the camp, and he'll also be with us here in the midweek service. We call it the most encouraging service of the week. So be in prayer for Brother Odom as he preaches at camp, and we'll see him, God willing, on this coming Wednesday. We're praying especially for Pastor Sexton and the weekly Zoom calls, that the Lord would bless those. Over 1,500 pastors and Christian workers from around the world and around the country have joined in on that, and we're praying that that will continue to flourish and be a great blessing to more and more people week by week as it goes forward. We'd welcome you to join that on the Zoom call on Tuesdays. If you'd like to do that, you're welcome to. And then right around the corner, our Crown College dorms open on Friday, August the 19th. And then the first day for Temple Academy is Tuesday, August the 9th. So we are fastly approaching those dates. Let's be in prayer for the academy, for the college, as they begin this fall semester. May God bless it in a very special way. You'll also notice our International Baptist Friends Conference coming up on the 16th through the 19th. And we're praying that the Lord will make this a very special meeting, where many will be encouraged in the area of evangelism and church planting, and God is able to do great things. We're trusting Him to do that in this conference coming up, so you be in prayer for that. I'd like to ask Aaron Hester to come and pray and lead us in prayer in just a few moments as we pray about some specific needs. Perhaps you have a pen and you'd like to write down some of the needs that I'll mention, and we're praying much for the folks who are listed here. Jackie Couch is recovering from surgery, and so let's continue to pray for her. And then we've had several newborns, and we'd like to congratulate all the parents and then also continue to pray for these. The young Pearson James Whiteside is in the neonatal intensive care unit and was born early this morning, and so we're thankful for that. We're very grateful for Magnolia Elizabeth Sheridan, so let's pray for her. She was born on Saturday, and so we're thankful for that, and we're wishing that family our best and our prayers as well. And then let's continue especially to pray for Everett Farrell. And he was born this past week, and we're praying for Cody and Savannah, mom and dad. But Everett's been in the NICU at UT and still there, and so we're praying much that the Lord would bless him. He was born prematurely, and so we're praying that the Lord would really undertake and help him and be a blessing to his family there. So let's continue to pray for Everett. You'll notice we have a lot of folks that we've been praying for that have been going through a difficult time with their health, and so we're praying much that the Lord would be with and help Robin Owens and Rick Wittenberger, Beth Homan, Carol Huang, Jesse McBride, and Norma Jean Griffith. We know when we pray that God hears our prayers and answers our prayers, and we're thankful to have this opportunity to pray together. And so as Aaron comes to lead us in prayer, I hope you'll join us as we pray and ask God to meet these needs.
Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to come before thy presence. We thank you for the love that you show upon us, the everlasting love that you love us with. And Lord, we thank you that thou art good. And Lord, we come before you asking that you would be with us, that you would meet with us in this meeting, that we would truly sense thy presence. We pray, Father, that you would help our speaker, that he would be filled with thy spirit, and that you would use him to speak to our hearts. We know, Lord, that you are with us. We pray for more faith to believe that. And Lord, we ask specifically for these that we've heard mentioned tonight. We pray that you'd be with Jackie Couch. We pray, Father, that you would bless her, that you would raise her up, that you'd strengthen her. And Lord, I pray that you would also be with the Whitesides and their newborn baby. We pray, Father, that you would use this baby to accomplish thy will in this earth, and that you would help the Whitesides, that you continue to give them wisdom and strength as they raise these children. We pray, Father, for the Sherrod family and their daughter Magnolia. We pray, Father, that you would be with them and that you would help them, Lord, as they're parenting. We pray for Magnolia. We pray that she would grow up to be a godly young lady and that you would use her to accomplish thy will in this earth. We pray, Father, for Everett Farrell going through this difficult time in the NICU. We pray, Lord, that you would be with them, that you would comfort their parents, and Lord, that you would use this child, that you would raise this child up, and that you would meet their needs. Give the doctors wisdom as they're working with Everett, and we'll give you the glory for it. We pray, Father, for these who are dealing with cancer. We're asking that thy blessing would be upon them. We know that thou art the great physician. You can do anything. So we're praying, Father, for Robin Owens and Rick Wittenberger, Beth Homan, Carol Wong, as they're working through this cancer. We know, Lord, that you are able to heal them. And we're praying for thy will to be accomplished. We're continuing, Lord, to pray for Jesse McBride and Norma Jean Griffith. We pray, Father, that thy will would be accomplished and that you would get the glory and honor through the lives of these people. We pray this in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
It's a wonderful thing that the Temple Baptist Church is known as a praying church. And it's a wonderful thing to pray and know that God hears our prayers and answers them. Our choir is singing. You pray for them. The title of their song, My Hope is Jesus.
Jesus, love, and I just live. On Christ, the Son, and God.
That's a blessing. I want you to take our crown hymn book and find hymn number 90. Over the hilltops, down from the skies, sweeping this way, we're praying for revival. Amen. We're praying for the coming revival. We know it's coming. Someone said, when? Well, we don't know exactly when. We just know God would send it, and we're trusting him for it. I want you ready to sing that in just a moment. Continue to pray for Mr. Tomlinson and his wife and their children. They're at the Passage Northwest, and they're doing a great job for God. That's 120 acres of property in the Montana mountains, and they're having a good time. He preached today for Mr. Greg Boyle in Washington State. So good things are happening. We miss them, but we'll be happy to see them coming back. But we're glad they can be there, and just keep praying for them. Keep believing God. We're in a Bible study on the joy of church membership. Believe and belong. Don't just believe, but belong. And people are missing the importance, the essential of the local church, the pillar and ground of the truth. And we need to know all we can know about it. Love it, support it. If you don't have a copy of this book we're studying in our Bible teaching Sunday school, they'll be available for you after the evening meeting. And then here's a new book you may or may not have, just out for a little bit, on what to look for in a life's mate. Some of you are saying, it's a little late for me. But there's some good things here for you. What I've done is take 40 things from the book of Proverbs and talk about those 40 things that you look for in a life's mate. It's especially good for you young people and for young people who are still single. And I hope you get a copy of it and let the Lord use it in your life. Just tell the people at the table when we're finished. We'll be glad to try to get it for you. God bless you. Now, if you're visiting with us, we want you to remain seated. That's our seat of honor. You're our honored guest. And we thank God for you. But before we greet the visitors and sing the song, I want Jane Devereaux to stand up. Jane, where are you? Come on now. Right there. Yes. Stand. Stand, Jane. You know, you have to be an obedient lady. Jane and her husband, Jerry, are my precious friends for a lifetime. I'm talking about a half a century. And Jerry's now with the Lord. I was their pastor 11 miles from New York City in the greater New York City area. And they served the Lord there with me and helped us in so many things at the Madison Avenue Baptist Church. That's many, 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 many years ago, and we had a marvelous time. Jerry was always a right-hand man, helping me in so many things. And Jane, such a blessing. Jane now, after all these years and Jerry with the Lord, is going to be with her daughter in New Jersey. And she'll be moving there. She can't stay gone forever, but she's going to be moving there, and some of you want to say a parting word to her. But Jane, we love you, and thank you for the kind letter you wrote me. I will always be your pastor. I feel sorry for some guy you're going to have to go listen to and preach up there in New Jersey. Give him a hard time. Tell him, say, that's about the way Brother Sexton would do it, you know. You'd be a good church member and be a good girl up there. But we love you, and we thank God for you. Wonderful. If you call the Temple Baptist Church your church home, I want you to stand with us and we'll sing it together. Over the hilltops, down from the skies. This is another song we brought back from Northern Ireland. And one that Brother McCrea taught us. And we just said we've got to have it. So when we built our crown hymn book, we brought 60-something songs from that part of the world, put them in our hymn book, that were not songs that we normally were singing in America, but they were singing them over there, and we enjoy it. So Stephen, come along and help us, will you please? Hymn number 90, Sweeping This Way.
Amen. Let's join together and sing this wonderful hymn, hymn number 90.
Sweeping this way, sweeping this way, yes. Yeah,
singing, let's greet those nearest as the choir comes to join you at this time.
Ask our ushers, if they would, to come forward to receive our offering this evening. And we're thankful that we have this opportunity to worship the Lord in paying the tithe and giving above and beyond the tithe in our offerings. I'd like to ask Dr. Patton, if he would, to come and lead us in our prayer in just a moment for the offering. Our Temple Baptist Church Orchestra this evening will be playing a medley about heaven, and we're looking forward to that. Always thankful that we have an opportunity to be a blessing. Many missionaries around the world are gifted and helped every month as we faithfully give, and we're able to get the gospel to our community and here in our local area, reach people with the gospel, and we're thankful for that. And so let's be faithful in our giving as Dr. Patton comes to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you. You are the God of the universe. You've made everything. You have everything, but you have given us a chance to participate in your work, and we thank you for that. And so, Father, tonight we bow before you and pray that you would help us to be faithful in our giving. We pray, Father, that you would take what we give, and as you have multiplied the fishes and the bread, that you would take this also and multiply it for your use and for your glory. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Danny and Orchestra. Great job. Reminds us all of where we're going someday, to be with Jesus. Amen. It's been our great joy to have Brother McCrea and his wife, Ann. They have been true friends to us and to our ministry, not only in Great Britain and all the things God led us to do there. They've taken an interest in the work of God here, and we praise the Lord for it. Here's a real man of God who has served God and country. He serves notably in the House of Lords, in that august body of people, and then is a leader in his own country, in Northern Ireland, in the work of the Lord. He's a mighty preacher of the Lord's word. I enjoy hearing him. I enjoy his spirit. I enjoy talking to him. We have a mutual friend who's now in heaven, Dr. Ian Paisley, and I remember, I always will remember, when Dr. Paisley was with us for a revival meeting, and Brother McCrea was here leading the music and preaching also in that meeting, and I asked Brother Paisley to come back and be with us in another meeting. He said, oh, but God worked in such a mighty way in that meeting, I don't think we'll ever have it happen just like that again. We'll just see what we can leave that with the Lord and see if it'll happen. But thank you for your friendship, William. God bless you. Thank you for your encouragement. Every time I'm together, I talk about the fact that we started out about the same time preaching, over a half a century of it. He pastored the same church for over half a century. And the faithful pastor he was, he was used of God to encourage us so many times. All of our people who have traveled to Northern Ireland can tell you what a blessing these people have been to us. What a blessing. They're great cooks, too. And when they fed this army we took over there, we decided one time we'd take the Crown College Choir. About 130 or 40 young people. And we didn't even ask. We just said, they're coming. And they just rolled out the red carpet and fed us. We sang everywhere and just enjoyed it. What memories we have, precious memories. And to God be the glory for all of it. I want you to pray for Brother William as he preaches. I've got in the back of my mind, when he's finished preaching, we're going to have him sing, but I won't put that on him right now. I just want you to be praying for him. Just before he comes, Stephen and Lydia are going to come and sing. And the song is about the coming of the Lord. This could be the day. Amen.
As the plan of God unfolds, Christian, won't you help the hopeless? Won't you feed their hungry souls?
Brother, sister, time is short now. Serve in love and live by faith.
Turns in glory. This could be the day.
could be the day.
Once again, I want to thank your pastor for the invitation to come and share with you. We pray that God will richly bless us as we open God's precious and God's holy word. I count Crown College, both the UK division and here, as my friends, brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus. It's a privilege to serve with them, and I pray that God will richly bless them and continue to use them mightily for the glory and the honor of the Savior. The Lord is doing great things in the United Kingdom through them, and I trust that you continue to pray for them, that God will continue to do that for his honor and for his glory alone. Let's open our Bibles together, please. We're turning to the book of John's Gospel in the chapter 5. And we're just going to read a verse from God's precious word, and then we'll pray, and then we'll come to bring the word that God has laid upon our hearts. John's Gospel, chapter 5, and the verse number 24. Follow the reading of God's infallible truth. The Lord Jesus is speaking here. He said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." Amen. Let's just bow our heads in prayer. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we thank thee for thy precious word. Thy word is truth. We thank thee that though heaven and earth may pass away, that thou hast said, my word shall never pass away. And O God, tonight we come reverently and we come humbly before thy throne, and we ask of thee that thou wilt anoint us with that power that we need to bring this message that thou hast laid upon our hearts. We thank thee it's the entrance of thy word that giveth light. And I pray that by thy Holy Spirit that thou wilt take of this word and apply it to the hearts of the hearers, and for those tonight who are not saved, that, O God, that thou wilt save them, that thou wilt bring them unto thyself, that they might know life eternal, which is found in Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ alone. And so to this end, I take the promised Holy Ghost, the blessed power of Pentecost. O God, fill me to the uttermost. I take, Lord, undertake for me, cover me in the blood, and give me power to preach thy truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In this fifth chapter of the book of John's Gospel, we find the Lord Jesus Christ comes to the city of Jerusalem. And as he comes to Jerusalem, he comes by the sheep market. There is a pool. And in that pool, in the Hebrew tongue, it is called Bethesda, or the House of Mercy. It has five porches and five inscriptions, the number of grace. And thank God, here we see grace and we see the manifestation of the mercy of God. Now there at that pool, the Bible says in verse 3, that there lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind and halt and withered, waiting for the waters to move. And here we find indeed a great multitude of people who are hurting. They're miserable. They're indeed longing for their lives to be changed, because the Bible says they're waiting for the moving of the water. I wonder tonight, are you looking and are you longing for your life to be changed? Maybe there's someone here tonight and you've come into this service and you're not saved. You know nothing of God's saving power or saving grace in your life. And my friend, you realize that you're bound and you're fettered and you're chained by your sin, and you long for your life to change. I want to tell you that we have tonight in this blessed book of God and in the word that God has given me tonight, that God has the power to change your life and to make you whole. Thank God we find that the Lord Jesus, he comes to this place and there's a great multitude of impotent folk. Now, the word of God tells me that whilst there was a multitude here, if you go down to verse number 5, it says, "And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity 38 years. And then it says, when Jesus saw him. Now, the word of God doesn't say that the Lord Jesus came and he met others and the other individuals in this great multitude. But the Lord had come to that place for this certain person. And I want to tell you, my friend, salvation is a very personal thing. Amen. You're not saved in a multitude. It's a personal experience. in your heart, and it is a work of God within your soul, because the Word of God says, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And I wonder tonight, have you have experience of that new birth? Now, the Lord Jesus came, and he came for this certain man, and the Word of God says Jesus saw him. My friend, tonight, I want you to know that you might be here in this great congregation of people, and maybe you say, nobody sees me, or nobody knows me, or nobody understands what I'm going through. Friend, that's not true. There's one who sees you tonight, and I'll tell you this, he sees you not in a crowd, he sees you as an individual person, and he's come tonight, and I believe that God can meet you at the very point of your individual need. Now, the Lord Jesus saw him lie. The Word of God says, thou, God, seest me, and thou knowest me altogether. There's nothing that God doesn't see or know about you or me, my friend. There are no secrets as far as you and I are concerned with God, because God sees everything. He sees everything in our hearts, and he knows our standing. Maybe you're trying to put on a pretense tonight. You want people to believe that you're right with God, that you're saved, that you're just a part of the family of God, and yet God knows different, because God looks into your heart, and he knows that you've never repented of your sin. You've never turned from your sin. My friend, listen, you can make all the declarations that you want to make. You can sign every little form that you want to sign. But if your heart, you have not repented of your sin, you have not turned from your sin, you have not turned to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you are not saved, and you need to get right with God. Forget about the pretense. Forget about the show. Forget about what other people see. Thou, God, seest me, and thou, God, knowest me altogether. Now, the Word of God says here in verse 5, or verse number 6, that Jesus saw him lie, and Jesus knew that he had now been now a long time in this case. The Lord Jesus knew all about him. And I'm glad tonight, when the Lord Jesus came to that man, the Lord Jesus Christ knew exactly what he needed. My friend, listen, the Lord knows exactly what you need. And if you know, if you're still in your sin, then you need God's salvation. Child of God, maybe tonight you're discouraged and you need encouragement. Then may God encourage your heart, because the God who met the need of this man lying at the pool of Bethesda, that house of mercy, thank God's the very God can meet your need tonight in this congregation here in Temple Baptist Church. Now, God not only saw him, the Lord Jesus not only knew him, but thank God he did something else. The Lord spake unto him. Look at verse 6. It says, and Jesus saw a lie, and Jesus knew that he had now been a long time in this case. And Jesus said unto him, wilt thou be made whole? Maybe you say, what a strange question for the Lord Jesus to ask this man, wilt thou be made whole? My, that's why he was lying there. He had been lying there in a miserable and a state, a pitiful sight, and he was lying. And the Lord Jesus looked into his heart. Jesus asked him a question, and he said, wilt thou be made whole? Because let me tell you, there are people tonight who know they need to be saved, but are not saved. There are people here in this service tonight, and listen, it's not that you don't know, because God's servants here have preached Sunday after Sunday, week after week, and gospel campaigns as the Word of God has gone forth, and you know your need, and the Spirit of God has shown your need, that you're lost in your sin, that you're without Christ and you're without hope, but you're still not saved. You're still not saved. And Jesus says, wilt thou be made whole? Do you really want to be made whole? My friend, is that why you have come tonight? Or you just come to experience the singing, or you experience just the fervor of a meeting and be amongst this company of people? Or have you come with a purpose that your life would be changed, that you would never be the same again? And Jesus asked him the question. He said, wilt thou be made whole? You know, the empty man answered him in verse number 7, sir, I have no man, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool, when I'm coming, another steppeth down before me. Listen, he realized that he had no power of himself. He tried. He said, when I'm coming, in other words, he tried his best. to get into the pool when the water was stirred. He tried his best, but he couldn't make it. And maybe there's someone here tonight, and listen, you want to get to heaven. You want to be sure that you're getting to heaven, friend, at the end of life's journey, and you're trying your best. But I tell you this, with all your trying, you'll never make it. Because you're not saved by your own efforts. The Word of God says, for by grace are you saved. That's the unmerited, undeserved favor of God to your soul. By grace are you saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is not of works, lest any man should boast. And he said, Lord, I've no man to put me into the pool. Nobody cares enough to help me. You know, my friend, listen, he said, while I'm coming, when the water was stirred and others were making their way, and here's this poor man has been lying there for 38 long years. He's been in this infirmity. And he's tried his best for all these years to get. But somebody steps in before him. He doesn't make it. Maybe, friend, you've been coming to gospel meetings for years. And in your heart is a longing, a desire to be saved. But be honest before God, you're still without Christ. You're still without hope. And you're nearer hell than ever you've been before. What an awful situation. What an awful tragedy. And maybe you're saying, well, I'm trying. I remember years ago, a young man used to come to my home in the early hours of the Sabbath morning. He'd been out drinking the night before. You know, on a Sabbath morning, about 2 o'clock in the morning, he would bang the door, my front door. And I would come down the stairs and I would let him in, and he would sit there and tears would run down his cheeks. And he said, look at me. He said, I tried. Preacher, I've tried to break the power of booze, but it's beat me again. You see, friend, it's not trying Jesus, it's trusting Jesus. Amen. That's how people are saved. And this poor man has tried, but after all these long years, he's failed, still failed. But thank God Jesus didn't leave him there. The Lord Jesus, speaking to him, he said, verse 8, he says, rise, take up thy bed and walk. This man had an infirmity. He had a physical infirmity. And the Lord Jesus says to him, rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole. Thank God his sickness was gone after 38 years. His weakness was gone. The man, he had tried to get into the pool, but he could never make it. Why? Because he had no strength. He had no strength to get up on those legs. And yet Jesus said in the moment, he said, just rise, get up. He says, take up your bed. That little mattress that he was lying on. He says, take it up and walk. And just with one word from Jesus, rise, friend, it says immediately the man was made whole. And he took up his bed and he walked. There's the power of Christ. You know the words of that song, it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he can do for you. I remember a man in Northern Ireland, he used to be a member of Parliament. And he was, during the war, he was one of the elite squad and had to fight for his country. And I remember talking to him about his need of God's salvation. He said, but preacher, I couldn't be saved. If you only realized what I had to do in the war for my country. I had to go behind the enemy lines and do things that I cannot tell you. He said, God couldn't save me. And I would try to convince him, and I would say to him, Johnny, God's able to save you too. It's no secret what God can do. What he's done for me, Johnny can do for you. But he couldn't take it in. Then his wife took ill. He asked one of my colleagues in the ministry to go to see his wife because she was dying. She wasn't saved. But Johnny had a burden to see his wife in heaven. My friend went to see her and, thank God, led that dear wee lady to Jesus Christ. Shortly after that, Johnny got saved too. Amen. You know what he found out? God could work a miracle in Johnny's heart. It wasn't too hard for God. And listen, maybe the devil's saying to you, there's no use you trusting Jesus. There's no use you calling upon him because God will never save you. There's no hope for you. Look at the life that you've lived. Let me tell you, my friend, the word of God says there's none righteous. And God says, no, not one. And maybe you've lived a dark and evil and sinful life, friend, but so has everyone else. Because there's no clean sin. God says if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth's not in us, we're lying. If we say we have not sinned, we're calling him a liar. Why? Because God says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And I don't care how good you are. Just remember what God's word says. All your righteousnesses, that's the best that you can do. All your righteousness are as filthy rags in God's sight. And there's some people and they're trying to offer their filthy rags of their own righteousness to God, friend. But they'll never do. They'll never do. And here's this man and he puts the bed on his head and he walks and his body's healed. His body's healed. It's a wonderful thing when you find people physically healed, isn't it? Those that have had infirmity for years. And maybe you've prayed for loved ones for years that God would heal them. And you long for God to do it. I have a burden in my heart for that to happen in my family circle, for God to heal. But listen, my friends, it's wonderful when God heals. When man can do nothing, then God steps in and does everything. Praise his glorious and wonderful name. This man's healed physically. He leaves that place and my, the Jews, the Bible says, they see this man walking. It's a Sabbath day. Verse number 10, this is just not lawful for thee to carry thy bed. Listen, they didn't talk about him walking. They didn't care about the miracle that had happened to him. They didn't care about the 38 long years he's been lying. Physical disability. No, they never mentioned that, didn't they? All they mentioned was you're walking with a bed in your head. They didn't care. Let me tell you, my friend, the world doesn't care you go to hell. The devil doesn't care because that's his plan for you. That your soul's damned for a lost in a lost eternity forever and ever. And that here we find all they could do was find fault, a man walking, healed after all these years. You know the man, he just answered in verse 11. He said, he that made me whole said unto me, take up thy bed and walk. He told me. And they said to him, well, what man? You know, friend, he didn't know who he was. He didn't know this was Jesus. He said, what man? And he said, he that was healed wist not, verse 13, who it was. Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude in that place. Listen carefully. This man's body was healed, but his soul wasn't. And maybe you think the healing of your body is the greatest thing in all the world, friend, for you to happen to you if you're sick tonight. But let me tell you, you have a sin-sick soul. And you and I will, even no matter how long we get here, or short it may be, we have to leave. We've got to go. For the word of God says, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. The word of God tells us, we know not what a day may bring forth. Not one day. Not one day. But at best, we'll have to go. Yes, it's not the healing of your bodies the greatest miracle. It's the healing of a sin-sick soul. For thank God that healing's eternal. Amen. It's forever. Amen. But you know, the Lord Jesus didn't leave him just with a healed body. Look what the Bible says. Look at number verse 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole. And then he says this, sin no more. You see, the problem that had to be dealt with was sin. Was sin. Now listen, we can talk about sickness, but we don't want to talk about sin. But Jesus did. Because I believe, friend, this sickness was because of sin. This sickness was because of particular sin in his life. And Jesus says, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. And friend, I want to tell you tonight, if you're going to be saved, if you're going to be in heaven, you have got to turn from your sin. You have got, as the word of God says, repent and be converted. And I know it's not a message that's often preached by many today. It's a message of repentance. There's got to be a turning away from your sin. You can't go on. I hear people saying, well, I made a profession, but my look at their lives, friend, and they're just carrying on in their own sinful ways. There's no change. What the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. There's a change. And I'll tell you, you can have a profession tonight, but if there's not a change in your life, if you haven't repented of your sin and turned to the Lord Jesus Christ, and your life has changed, friend, listen, it'll not matter about all your professions. You're lost. You see, it's possession. That's what you need. It's knowing the Lord Jesus and receiving the great gift that God has for you as well as for me. And here we find the Lord Jesus deals with his sin. Not only his sickness, he deals with his sin. And he tells him, sin no more. He's got to turn from his sin. And the Bible says in verse 15, the man departed. Now his life was so changed. He wasn't ashamed now. He didn't know who Jesus was, but now he knows who he is. And what does it say? And the man departed and told the Jews it was Jesus. Amen. It was Jesus. What did Paul say? I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. My friend, we are living in a day and an age, the ungodly are unashamed. They're brass-necked about their sin. Yet many of God's people are ashamed to nail their colors to the masthead and say, I belong to Jesus. Amen. I'm a child of the King. I'm saved. The man said, it's Jesus. Jesus, which hath made me whole. I'm whole. Body, yes, but in soul. Thank God he was changed. You see, whenever the Jews heard that, they went after Jesus. They didn't care about this man. In actual fact, the word of God tells us they sought the more to kill Jesus. Can you imagine that? Verse 18, therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, the one who had healed this poor soul that had been there for those years. But no, the Lord Jesus Christ, when he was faced with them, he wasn't silenced by them. And the Lord Jesus Christ didn't back down, but with a holy boldness declared himself to be God in his nature, in his works, in his power, in judgment, and worship. And then he made this declaration. in verse 24. He said, verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. You know, there's some people, and preachers faithfully tell them they need to be saved, but they make this mistake. They don't tell them how. And friend, it's not enough for a preacher to stand on the pulpit and tell a person that you're lost in your sin and you need to be saved. But listen, you need to tell them how. Do you remember whenever the Philippian jailer came there to Paul and Silas? He fell before them. And he said this. He said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now, friend, I don't know how or when he knew he needed to be saved, but he did. That was the question he asked. He asked about being saved, but he didn't know how. And he said, what must I do? Tell me, what have I got to do to be saved? I remember coming back from America some years ago. My mom asked my sister to give me a call and said her brother, my uncle, who lived on his own, wanted to speak to me. I went down that very afternoon. It was a Sabbath afternoon. I'd just come home from America. I preached in the morning. I went straight down to my uncle after lunch, and I went down to speak to him. I said, well, Uncle Herbie, you wanted to see me. I didn't know what it was about. And he said this to me. He says, tell me, William, how can I be sure of heaven? You know, I had the joy of opening the Word of God and showing my uncle that day God's way of salvation. Not the church's way. It's God's way of salvation. You know, I never saw any grandparents of my family. My grandmother, grandfather, from both sides of my parents had died before I was born. But my mom used to tell me that her mother, when she was leaving a little family of 8 children behind in death, that night they were waiting in stillness and quietness in that home. And then down the hallway they heard singing. And they made their way down the hallway and down to the mother's room, and they looked into the room, and there a mother had pulled herself up in the bed before she died, and she was singing. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Amen. Spread the glad news all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. I want to tell you tonight, he's still doing it. Still saving. He's able to save to the uttermost. Right from the very darkness and then the guttermost of hell. Thank God he's able to save. He's able to save to the uttermost all that come unto God by him. Jesus saves. Just as this wee man said, I want to tell you, it was one called Jesus that made me whole. And I'm glad that I'm able to say to you tonight, Jesus made me whole. Amen. Jesus saved my guilty soul. Now notice what it says here. Here's the speaker. I say unto you. It's the Savior speaking. I tell you, it doesn't matter about the preacher. But it does matter when Jesus speaks. You better listen. And here we find the Savior is speaking. Remember the Lord Jesus Christ? He said to the leper, he said, be clean. Praise God, he was. He said to the demon of Gadara and to the demons that were in him, come out of him. Thank God they had to go. He said to Lazarus, who was in the tomb, Lazarus, come forth. Praise God, he came forth. You see, the Savior, when he speaks, there's none can speak like him. Do you remember the Pharisees and the priests? They sent the officers to arrest the Savior. And they came back, and you know what they said to him? Never a man spake like this man. So the speaker is Jesus. I say unto you. But here's the subject. Notice what it says at the end of that verse. But it's passed from death unto life. Notice what it didn't say. You see, you and I are dying. You and I are passing from life to death. But that's not what the Lord Jesus talks about. He puts it the other way. He said, but is passed from death unto life. Because you see, the very subject that I'm speaking about tonight is that the Lord Jesus Christ saves people. He saves them because we are spiritually dead. We are in death. Yes, physically we're dying, but spiritually we're dead. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, you hath he quickened or made alive who were dead in trespasses and in sin. And spiritually speaking, before God, friend, sinner, you're dead. That's why you can't do anything for yourself. That's why you can't help yourself. That's why you can't save yourself. Why? Because you're dead. A dead man can't help himself. And neither can you. And so, spiritually, you're dead. And you're headed to eternal death, which is in a Christless hell for all eternity. But the Lord Jesus Christ is speaking about passing from death unto life. To life. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus said to Nicodemus, he said to him, marvel not that I said unto thee, you need to be born again. You need a new birth. Now, Nicodemus, he was a religious man. He was one of the teachers of that day. And yet he said, how can a man be born when he's old? He couldn't understand it. And friends, let me tell you, in reality, neither can you, because you're dead in trespass and in sin. It has to be the work of the Spirit of God. The preacher can't save you. The preacher can't change your life, my dear friend. It is only the Lord Jesus can change your life, and the blessed power of the Spirit of God that can convict you of your sin and convince you that Jesus Christ alone is the Savior. And by the Spirit of God, he draws you unto himself. That's the miracle of God's salvation. It's the work of God. The work of God alone. But notice it says here, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my words. You've got to hear the word. And that's why tonight I'm sent to preach the word, because God has, through the foolishness of preaching, God ordains to save them that believe. That's why God, Paul, when he was writing to young Timothy, he said to Timothy, Timothy, preach the word. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season, but preach the word, Timothy. And the Lord Jesus says, he that heareth my word. Romans chapter 10 says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. And friend, that's why you need to get your loved ones in. That's why that you need to be urgent about reaching your unconverted loved ones lest they die and go to a lost eternity forever. Oh, that God would give us the urgency again to go out, as the word of God says, go out and compel them to come in. Get them into God's house. Get them into God's house to hear the word of God faithfully preached in this place. Mark tells us, take heed what you hear. Be careful who you listen to, friend. Oh, there's a lot of voices today, a lot of religious voices today. And yet, my friend, there's not a word about God and His Word. They don't take you to the Bible. They talk you about some person, some great person down the years and some intellectual. Let me tell you, my dear friend, a wayfaring man, though a fool may not err therein. Get to the book. It's the Word of God you need to preach. Preach the Word. Give me a man. Give me a woman, a person who's anointed to the Spirit of God with the Word of God in their hand to reach souls for Jesus Christ. And thank God, God will honor the preaching of His precious Word. He that heareth my Word. Take heed not only what you hear, take heed how you hear. I'm sure you read the parable of the sower. You remember the four grounds? There was that ground, the seed that fell by the wayside. There was the seed that fell on the stony ground. There was the seed that fell upon the thorny ground. And then there was the seed that fell on the good ground. And you read Mark's Gospel chapter 4, friend. And in every one of those, notice this, every one of them had this privilege of hearing. Hearing. Never take that privilege for granted. That you have the opportunity of hearing God's word preached. But notice, whilst every one of these had the opportunity to hear, there was only one ground that brought forth the fruit. You see, whilst everyone may have the opportunity to hear, not everyone responds to what they hear. And very quickly, notice a step here. He that believeth on Him that sent me. You see, you can't stop with hearing, friend. It's not simply a mere accepting of facts that will save you. You've got to take God at His word and you've got to believe. Believe. What did Paul and Silas answer to the question, what must I do to be saved? What was the answer? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And thou shalt be saved. My friend, you put your full weight, your total reliance, your total dependence upon the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's who He is. He's the Lord Jesus Christ. And you've got to believe Him. Rest upon the finished work of Christ. Listen, Nicodemus knowing was not enough. The woman at the well hearing was not enough. The Philippian jailer, yes, experiencing that night whenever he was trembling before Paul and Silas was not enough. Zacchaeus up the tree in his lost estate, but it was not enough. Jesus said, you've got to come down. And I want to go home with you. I want to tell you, friend, you can go home with the Lord tonight in your heart. Changed, saved, reconciled to God. Your sin separated you from God, but thank God now reconciled through the blood of Jesus' cross. You see, the Lord Jesus was the one who died as your substitute. In my place, condemned, He stood. He sealed my pardon with His blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. And Jesus said, he that believeth on Him that sent me hath everlasting life. There's a stipulation, friend. Hath everlasting life. Not might have. Not maybe have, but praise God, have. Amen. Not one day will have. But thank God now. What does the Word of God say? Now are we the sons of God. Yes. And friend, if you don't know now that you're saved, I beg you in God's name, come now. Jesus said, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow and red like crimson, they shall be as wool. A man came to D.L. Moody one time. He was worried he didn't feel saved. Moody looked at him and he said to him, "Sir, was Noah safe in the ark?" He said he certainly was. "Well," he said, "tell me, what made him safe? Was it his feelings or the ark?" Let me tell you, my friend, salvation of my soul, I rest upon his work that he finished at the cross. I have no other argument. I want no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that Jesus died for me. And thank God, Jesus says, if you believe, he said, you will have everlasting life. And then he says this, and shall not come into condemnation. Thank God, here's the soulless. We'll never go to hell. Well, the old devil would try to take us there if he could, but he can't. Thank God he's lost his power. He's lost his grip over us. We're children of the King now. We're resting in Jesus. Thank God he has got a hold upon us. And praise God, it says, no man shall pluck us out of his hand. And if you look in your Bible, you'll find that the word man is in italics. John chapter 10, verse 28. It means none, nothing. Man, woman, demon, devil shall be able to pluck us out of his hand, shall not come into condemnation, but is past. Here's the security. Work's done, friend. Is past from death unto life. What did the hymn writer say? What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. The old demon of Gadara, that day was changed forever. Zacchaeus came down from that tree and the Savior went home with him. Thank God he was changed forever. The old Philippian jailer, he had thrown Paul and Silas into the inner prison. And they started to sing praises unto God and pray, and God shook the old prison, and God shook the old jailer too. And that night he cried, "What must I do to be saved, friend?" Listen, and that night he was saved, and so was all his house. That night he got household salvation, because not only did he believe, but thank God that night every single one of the family believed too. And they were gloriously. And one of them said, yes, and they were changed forever. Lastly, Saul of Tarsus, riding down that road with such hate in his heart, the Lord stopped him. He was religious. But you know, whenever the Lord stopped him on the Damascus road, notice what he said. He says, "Who are you, Lord? Who are you?" He didn't know the Lord. But thank God, that day was changed. Changed forever. And this is the plan of God's salvation, friend. I say unto you, remember, this is not Dr. Sexton, with all the love of the pastor's heart for his congregation. This is Jesus speaking. Listen to him. I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. You don't need to go to hell, friend. You don't need to be lost. But thank God you can be saved. Will you come? Will you trust Christ? Notice there's nothing about confirmation, nothing about even baptism there. Nothing about church membership there, because these people are lost. These things follow after you're saved. You'll obey the Lord if you love him. You'll want to walk in his ways and in his path, and you'll want to honor him. But you've got to first come to him. Jesus says, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest." Thank God you can go home tonight rejoicing. Sins forgiven. Amen. Forever under the blood. And here's the last verse. Hebrews 10:17. "And your sins and iniquities will I remember no more." Gone. Oh, the devil may throw them in your face. The devil may rake them up and cast them in your face, but praise God, God says, "I remember them no more." Forever gone. Saved. And satisfied in Christ. Oh, come to Jesus this night for Jesus' sake. Amen.
I'm so happy when someone preaches the gospel and they speak to me like I never heard it before, like I never heard it, as if I never heard it. And with every point, I rejoice in it and what I have in the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? No doubt in a meeting like this, God is speaking to somebody who's holding on to something that gives you no assurance. No assurance. Because it's something other than Christ and Christ alone. You can settle that. Let us pray together. I get certain things, certain songs on my heart. The Holy Spirit awakens us. Trust him. Trust the Lord now. I will rise and go to Jesus. He'll embrace me in his arms. In the arms of my dear Savior, oh, there are 10,000 charms. Just let God speak to you. Now. Just let him speak to you now. Help us, Lord. Come, ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love, and power. Will you say, "I will arise and go to Jesus"? He will embrace me in his arms. In the arms of my dear Savior, oh, there are 10,000 charms. Come to the Lord. Our personal workers are here to pray with you if you need to pray. You need someone to pray with you. You've heard the gospel. You've heard the declaration that He He has power to save. How many of you have a troubled soul? You have a troubled soul because something about your salvation needs to be settled. Would you lift your hand, hold it high for prayer right now? Thank you. How many of you have someone you love? Sometimes you say they're backslidden. Sometimes you think they're lost. But they give no real evidence of having been born again, and your heart is so heavy for them. You exhaust yourself sometimes trying to be a witness to them. But you need God to break through in their lives. How many of you have someone like that on your heart? Someone that you know and love. Don't give up on God working on them. Let us stand for prayer. You come and in the stead of that person, pray for him, pray for her. But we're here also to talk to you about knowing the Lord as God speaks to your heart. Father, help us. We're poor and needy. Help us, we pray in Christ's name. I want us to sing hymn number 270. With all your heart, sing it out. You come as we sing.
I will arise.
while the instrument's playing softly. Some people are finishing praying. In the old days, we said doing business with God. I know some of you are praying for people I know that you know and love. And I want you to know God is able. He's able to break through. We all ought to pray for one another. Thank you. You may be seated. If you wish to return to your seat, you may. There's nothing quite like a family burden when it's for salvation. I thought several times while Brother McCrea was preaching, I would love to have him here for a revival meeting. I'm talking about an old-fashioned revival meeting. I could trust him to preach the gospel, not go on with some nonsense, and sing, and get all the young people involved in it, all the older people involved in it. I hope he'll pray about that. Coming here, he and his wife, and spending a few days with us and just preaching. We need it. Amen. We need it. We need this kind of preaching. Amen. Right from the Bible, just explaining the Word of God, talking about salvation. It motivates preaching. Thank you. Thank you. We have the Williams family here. Darren, Corey. They have the newest addition, Kaylee. They're dedicating her to the Lord. I want all the family to stand there together like that. Beautiful family. Darren is the chairman of our deacons. He was elected by the peers, the deacons. They want him to serve. It's an encouragement. And they're dedicating themselves to the Lord and their family and dedicating this new daughter to the Lord. As a church family, let's pray for them. They want to raise their children to serve the Lord. I said to Derek Moreland the other day on the phone, I said, I hear that Juliana is expecting another baby. He said, yes, number 7. I said, well, don't let anybody mock you or give you a hard time about it. Just take care of her. Take care of the children and have a happy, happy home. And for you, this is number 7. Amen. Faithful wife, beautiful children. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for families who are working at it, who are taking it seriously, yet happy people, pleasant people, who love you, love serving you, and love one another. Touch this family and bless them. May each of these children grow strong for thee and for thy glory, and be the man, the woman, each of them, that is your design for them to be. We pray especially for this new little one, Kaylee, that you will work in her heart. We give it all to you in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother McCrea to go to the piano. And Greg, you come up here with him, will you please? Jonathan, you stay over there with him. Jonathan is about the most gifted, I shouldn't say about, he's the most gifted young musician I know. As a matter of fact, he just made a trip to a seminary the other day, and he's got it. He's got it. But you fellas can concoct something. I know. William, is that your picture on that songbook? Is that you on that songbook? Yeah, I saw it. I was almost distracted looking down at it while you were preaching.
A long time ago.
I didn't know if that was your grandson or you.
No. That's me.
And you may have these guys get in on something, but I want to hear you, and we all want to hear you. Just enjoy it. I remember hearing you sing at Hialeah, maybe the first time. What a blessing. And we're thrilled to have you with us. Whatever God's put on your heart.
I got up Sunday morning, went to the church at 10. I listened and I heard what I heard time and again. The preacher spoke of sinful lives. Oh, I knew he talked of mine, but I was young. I said I'd plenty of time, plenty of time to decide where I'm bound. Is it to eternal darkness? Is it to the heavenly crown? I'm just a young man, not even in my prime, so I'll just wait. I've plenty of time. I walked down life's pathway, living as I used to live. I should beat the other fellow, I should get what life could give. Making money, it's not sinful. Having fun, it's not a crime. So I just wait. I've plenty of time. Plenty of time to decide where I'm bound. Is it to eternal darkness? Is it to the heavenly ground? For I'm just a young man, not even. Just wait. I've plenty of time. Before I knew what happened, earth seems had passed away, and millions stood before God's throne. It is the judgment day. Eternal darkness beckons, and the name God calls, it's mine. But I thought I'd plenty of time. Eternity comes, and there is no more time. Just to think of all the days that Christ could have.
Now, these men want to sing a song with you while you're at the piano. And they'll think about it for years to come. Yes. So, y'all work it out while I'm talking.
Saved me by his grace, then you take me by.
have a lot of that, couldn't we? Let's stand together, may we? Darren, I want you to bring your family here so people can come by and see the baby. And Brother William, if you and Ann would stand over there, if you'll help them do that, we appreciate it so much. Good. Very good. Amen. Wonderful. It's a pleasant thing to be with God's people. I want you to help me pray about this meeting. He's able to do that. And I often think there's one more big meeting in him. One more big meeting. If you stand here where people can greet you, I appreciate it so much. We've had a wonderful day. We thank the Lord for it. Amen. And let's rag on the Lord and run the devil down. Amen. Give him a hard time. It's a blessing to be here, isn't it? Amen. Thank you so much. Heavenly Father, continue to bless and guide us. Help us to move forward for your glory. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.